A few years ago, several years ago, can you hear me? Is that better? Okay, if you wave at me if I somehow fade out again. So several years ago, at a busy junction near the house where I live in North London, I used to see a man standing there, often hour after hour. He was old. He looked a bit shambolic. His clothes were put on awry. His hair was all over the place. And what he would do is he would wave his hand violently in the air over a long period of time. Often he held a piece of cutlery in his hand, sometimes a spoon and most frequently a fork, I think. And sometimes he seemed rather agitated and jangled, and sometimes he seemed peaceful, and sometimes he seemed almost exultant. And I assumed, rightly, as I was to discover, that he had dementia. And then one day, this old man just disappeared. And a few weeks later, I read his obituary in a newspaper. And it turned out that he was quite well known. He was an eminent musicologist. He loved Beethoven and Mozart. And he was a conductor. And I suddenly thought, maybe he wasn't just waving his hands in the air. Maybe he was conducting the traffic to the music that was in his head, the music that he'd loved all his life. Maybe what I was witnessing wasn't a scene of disorder and distress, but it was a scene that was more joyful than that, almost redemptive, someone laying a healing hand on the chaos that he saw in the world around him. I hope he was hearing music. So I've often thought about that old man standing at that busy junction, because I've often thought in the last several years about dementia, about what dementia means. My father, John Gerrard, had dementia, so he was a doctor and a scientist, eminently practical. He loved tying knots and mending china and just sorting people's lives, but also a bit mysterious, a bit eccentric. He believed in water divining and the power of dreams. He always stood a little bit out of touch from us all. He lived with his dementia for maybe even 10 years. He lived well with his dementia. So he lived at home with my mother, who at the time of his death he'd been married to for 61 years. He went for walks by the river. He worked in his beloved garden. He was a man who had a deep love of nature and always got solace from that. He watered the tomatoes and fed the little brown bird that came to the bird table, met up with his friends, told vivid stories about his past, teased his grandchildren, and was basically quite contented. So although he was going gradually into the darkness, and that felt scary sometimes, it wasn't terrifying. It was gradual. And this ended with a sudden rupture. So his life, from having been a gradual, gentle slide, became a precipitate decline. My father went into hospital. He had leg ulcers that couldn't respond to treatment. He stayed in that hospital for nearly 5 weeks, which is way too long to stay in a hospital for leg ulcers. And that hospital, which I've never mentioned because it's not the point, the name I've never mentioned because it's not the point, had very strict visiting hours. And also, when he was there, an outbreak of norovirus, so that there was a virtual lockdown of the ward in which he was staying. And I can hardly bring myself to imagine what he went through in those days when he just wasn't visited by people who knew him and loved him and recognised him. I think for the rest of my life I'll regret I was so obedient to those hospital rules. So he went into hospital healthy, mobile, articulate and contented. Then without us there to keep him walking, keep him eating, without us there to talk to him, to read to him, to hold his hand, to stroke his hair, to look him in the eye, to recognize him and to tell him that we loved him. He went off this cliff that I was talking about. So when we collected him, he was skeletal. He lost over a third of his body weight. He was immobile. He couldn't stand on his own two feet. He couldn't sit up in bed. He couldn't feed himself. He was completely inarticulate. He couldn't string two words together. He didn't recognize people that he'd lived with for decades of his life. And basically, he was lost. He'd become like a ghost in his own life. We took him home. We hired a hospital bed, and he lay in that in the downstairs room of his house, looking out at the garden that he loved so much. And we thought we could maybe get him back. If we did all the things with him and for him that we hadn't done in those 4 weeks, we could bring him back. But we were too late. So he was like some kind of great ship, and the ropes had been cut, and there was no pilot on board, and he was drifting out to sea. So he lay for 9 months in that little room downstairs, and he was no longer living with dementia. He was dying with dementia, a radically slowed down form of death, so that when he finally left us, it was a bit of a relief. Death can be a great kindness, and after death, people can be returned to you, and you remember them, you remember all their selves. Anyway, after my father died, because I understood far too late the importance of connection, of connectivity, of keeping people safe and protected by their known environments, I started a campaign, named for him, named John's Campaign. And it has this absolutely simple, single-issue message, which is that the carers of people who live with dementia should have the same right as parents of sick children to accompany them when they go into hospital or leave home in any way. And it's as simple as that. But underneath that simple message, there's a whole world that we need to learn about, which is a world of vulnerability. When people have dementia, they gradually become defenseless, and they're at our mercy. They're at the mercy of people who love them, and they're at the mercy of the kindness of strangers. So because of my father's radically slowed down death, and then because of the campaign that I've been running for the last 3 or 4 years, I've thought a great deal about dementia. I've talked to scientists and to doctors and to philosophers and to artists, but above all, to carers and to people who are living with the illness. And I've thought about not just what dementia means to these people, but what it means socially, what it means philosophically, what it means emotionally, what it means almost existentially. So I used to say, very blithely, that I'm made of my memories. That's who I am. What happens when memories fall away? Are we unmade? I used to say that I used to believe that my value came from my autonomy, my agency, my independence, my purpose, my vigor, my place in the world, my ability to communicate with other people, my ability to have reciprocal relationships. That's where I placed my value. What happens when we lose all those capacities and none of that is left? Do we not have value any longer? And I think I used to believe that dementia in its later stages can demolish the self, that it's the cruelest kind of disease because it unpicks that which makes us human. And I do not believe that anymore. I strongly don't believe that. I believe that dementia can demolish a sense of self, identity, self-consciousness, reciprocity, shame, all the things that make us into social beings. But I do not believe that it takes away a self. I don't believe that my father, when he was lying in his hospital bed downstairs, had gone, although I think he was lost to himself. I think if I was a Christian, I'd call it a soul. I think he still had his soul there, his essence. He still had a smile that only he would ever have. He still had a tone about him that will never come again in another human body. So after these last 4 years, I've come away feeling that that's what we need to think about. We need to think about the fact that nobody is not a self. Nobody is just an object. Nobody is just a body in a bed. Everybody is a subject. Everybody is precious. And we should acknowledge that and have a kind of collective responsibility for it. Now, there's a huge amount of loss and loneliness and stigma and terror and desolation around the illness. But there is also, as I have discovered, a huge amount of joy and adventure and fun and courage and love, love in bucket loads that I've witnessed. And the thing that I want to emphasize now is the power of connections. I guess if my book had a subtitle, it would be Only Connect. We live in a world of relationships, in a world of meanings, and we have to kind of hold on to that. And I think I've witnessed some amazing things over the past few years of people who we think are gone, but we can recover them again. People who seem completely lost, but we can find them again. So I've danced with a woman with dementia in a East End London hall, and she was this tiny Jamaican woman, and she had quite bad dementia, and she was very anxious. She couldn't really speak. She really couldn't communicate with me. And then the music struck up and we took to the floor, and that woman was fantastic. She twirled and she spun, and she taught me, she was way better at dancing than I was, she taught me how to dance. She became my teacher in that beautiful, reciprocal, democratic space that got opened up between us. I visited a hospital where a man was lying in bed. He had dementia. It was his 80th birthday, and there was nobody to visit him. And the nurses ran out to the shop and bought a treacle tart because they discovered that his mother used to make him treacle tarts when he was a little boy. And this man, who'd been very grim and withdrawn, he was overcome with emotions. He was kind of weeping and laughing, and he was singing, and the nurses were singing and weeping, and I was weeping as well, because it's these acts of kind of small acts of intimate kindness to each other that kind of keep us bound to each other in the world. I've been to art classes with people with dementia who've always loved art and sat in front of paintings and discussed them. And they've taught me about those paintings. And they've also taught me about what they're like, about how I've thought about them. They don't become stupid with dementia. They have an illness. I've seen an old man sitting in a wheelchair, completely slumped and drooling and looking absolutely gone. And he's had music plugged into him, the music that he used to love when he was young, that he used to dance his daughter to school with. And the music was plugged in, and after a few seconds, his head lifts up. He starts to smile. Life returns. He actually starts to dance in his chair. It's like a miracle of somebody being refound, being revived by those acts of connection. And I've seen my mother, who's blind and very frail and bashed about by many years of strokes, running down hills because she likes to feel the wind in her hair and be free. And I have seen my father, very shortly before he went into his dark years, swimming in a lake in Sweden in twilight and singing a song to himself. And it was a song I'd never heard before and have never heard since. And it was a sight partly of loneliness, but partly of great joy. It was like the world was emptying into him and he was opening out to the world. And I've seen my father, deep in his dementia years, dancing with my mother to the music they used to dance to when they courted. And I've seen my father lying in his bed, unable to recognise me, unable to say his own name. And me and my four children and my partner, we stood round the bed and we chanted, I must go down to the seas again, the lonely sea in the sky, and all I ask is a tall ship and a star to steer her by. Because it was a poem that he used to read to us when we were little children. And my father, this old man who had nothing left, joined in with the poem. And in that messed up, mangled, bashed about body and mind, we found him. There was a way through to find him. So I would say to each and every one of us, not just when we're thinking about dementia, when we're thinking about how to be in the world, connect, only connect. And then I think of the old man standing on the junction, waving his fork, and I hope he was hearing music. Thank you.